Yes. If you don't have a communion cup, would you raise your hand? We'll make sure the ushers bring that around. Just keep your hand up and we'll do that. I have a card here that says thank you. Dear Mercer Baptist Church, thank you so much for the beautiful flowers and thank you for the many prayers and well wishes sent my way. I truly believe all your prayers pulled my family through a difficult time. Love, Miss Sandra and the whole Fielding family. Amen, church. I have to apologize. I found this card in the Christmas cards, so I apologize to the Fieldings, but they obviously keep praying for Joe and Sandra. Pray that God will keep strengthening them and healing them. Amen? Amen, church? We love our senior adults, and we just continue to pray for them. I would like you just, hey, if you know a senior adult that maybe is a shut-in or hasn't gotten out too long, just would you call them or encourage them this week? There's several of them on my heart, and I know if they probably get bugged hearing from me. So if you would, God lays somebody on your heart this week, would you reach out and love on them, call them, see them? Can y'all do that? Yeah, Brother Carl. Amen, Brother Carl. That didn't work. Amen? Amen. Okay. Hey, if you were here last night, yum. Amen. It was a good night. And for all of you who came, I know Bryce cooked, and I know Joe was cooking, Bill was cooking, and we had so many other people that were a part of that last night. I really enjoyed myself. And Jim, yeah, Jim helped too. Jim won the whole evening. If you didn't know that him and Dana are connected, they're one. Mentally and humorally, they are a perfect marriage. So if you want counseling, marriage counseling, call Jim and Dana. They'll teach you how to do it well. Amen? No? It was so uncanny. We did the dating game. And, so you have to write down what you think the other person is going to say. Even his jokes, she wrote down. I couldn't believe it. It was amazing, but we had a good time, didn't we? I love you guys. God's good, isn't he? And I'm so glad, over here, Fred. I'm so glad to be a part of a church family that loves on one another and has fun. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he? God's good all the time. He loves cutting up. I think Jesus has a great sense of humor because he kept saying, oh, y'all, little faith. But God is good, isn't he? Today I'm honored. We have Brother Wayne from Trinidad and his beautiful wife, Lisa, and daughter, Hope. Amen. We're so glad that you're here. And Brother Wendell Walker, I love Brother Wendell. He's a pastor up in McKenzie, Tennessee, and he was able to come down today. And so, Brother, I honor you, and I say thank you for bringing Wayne. He's partnered with Wayne's ministry in Trinidad for a lot of years, and I was able to connect with Wendell. I know Charles Maples has probably helped his ministry. I don't think Charles here today, Charles Maples. They've ministered with him for a great many and number of years, and that's how we met Brother Wayne. Brother Wayne, it's been 2 years since he's been here, and so he's going to bring a word of encouragement, word from the Lord, tell us a little bit about what's happening in Trinidad. And we're really thankful that you're here today, amen? And you got here after a whole year of trying to get here. We're so glad that you finally made it. But church, after he's done, we're going to take a special love offering for him and his family. So if you will, just pray for them and whatever God lays on your heart when we do that. I hope you'd honor Jesus in helping them. But let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll do communion. Let's pray. Father, this morning I say thank you for who you are. God, my mind kind of goes around the world, and people have already around the world been worshiping you for many, many hours already. Many, many services have already happened today, Father. Many, many of your church, your bride, has worshiped you and listened to your word. God, I pray for our brothers and sisters around the world, Father. We pray for Seth and Kelly as they prepare. Father, we pray for Justin and his wife as they're hopefully getting back into Thailand. Pray for Jay and Anna as they're preparing. A lot of problems with visas, a lot of problems trying to get in. God, I pray against the powers that be, Father, that are hindering the advancement of the gospel by putting regulations and, and hoops and hurdles in front of us to get out into the world. I pray that you remove all the obstacles so we could go back into the world, Father. God, I know the devil doesn't want that, but you're bigger than him. And so we pray that you remove all restrictions from international travel so we can go. Father, you've commanded us to go, but if we can't get there, Father, what good is it? And so, Father, we pray that you'd open up those borders. Father, for those hearing us online this morning, I pray they feel your presence. Even as they might be all alone, I pray you would encourage them and strengthen them. Father, we pray that your will be done in this life. God, we pray for Hamid. We pray for so many other pastors around the world that need you this morning. They have a lot of prayers, big prayers. And God, you can answer all of them. And this Father, this morning, I pray every heart and mind in this room, you know I'm hungry for more salvations. I want more people saved. So, Lord, if there's somebody in this room that can't say with 100% surety that they'll be in heaven when they die, I pray today is the day that they trust you and your sacrifice, that they died in their place. They're trusting you, Father, that you've forgiven them of all their sins. God, we as saints, I pray that today we are reassured of that salvation, encouraged, and given hope, Lord, that this world and all the troubles here ain't all it, because we've got a glorious future to see and be a part of. So, Father, we say thank you. Thank you for your bride. Thank you for your presence. And all God's people said, amen. You know, I was thinking about the Holy Communion. It's really this and baptism, the only thing that Jesus gives us. And then I was thinking this morning, and I was actually attacked by the devil. You're doing it every week. And so you're just making it a habit. You're just making it a tradition. I don't know about y'all, but a lot of things have happened this last week since I took this last. How about you? The Bible says that every time they gathered, they did this. What's the significance of this? We're remembering Jesus and what Jesus did, because, folks, we're only here because of Jesus. I got no reason to wake up early on Sunday morning and be with you. Amen? Unless it's Jesus. Jesus gave us this bread. And he said, this is my body that will be broken for you. As often as you do this, we know Isaiah 53 prophesied that by his stripes we are healed. Paul even said that our unity is needed and we receive it by the broken body of Jesus. So church, as we take this, if you have any brokenness of relationships, if you have any brokenness in your flesh, we recognize, we make a distinction that his body did it for us. Amen, church. Father, we want to say thank you for your broken body, for my wholeness, for my life, my completeness, for my shalom peace, God. Every area of my life restored, healed, and whole. Father, thank you for doing this for us. All of our relationships whole, all of our body whole. Church, take and eat. Amen. We need to be reminded that our sins are forgiven, church, because the devil continues to bombard us with thoughts that we're not forgiven. If you've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as the forgiveness of all of your sins, he's washed away all of your sins. And that devil will come back on you and say, you're not good enough, you're not forgiven enough, you're not enough. We declare by the blood of Jesus and his blood alone are all of our sins forgiven and washed clean. Amen, church. So as you take this, just declare, say, Jesus, thank you for washing away all my sins. Drink, church. Amen. Lord, thank you for your bride. Thank you for your fullness. Thank you for your unity and righteousness. Thank you, Father. Father, as we continue, Father, I pray every heart and mind is focused in on you. I pray, Holy Spirit, you'd minister to each and every person as they need it, and they don't leave the same. In Jesus' name, church, amen. Brother David.
Good morning. Reach in your pocket, pull that smile out, and put it on your face. I know you brought it with you, right? Hey, that's better. That improved y'all's face value. Amen. Amen. That's right. Amen. It's so good to see you this morning. If you read the Psalms, David is always saying, I will sing in the congregation. I will tell of all of his wondrous works. I will tell the wondrous story. Amen? Amen. We got a great story to tell, don't we, church? Hymn number 537, if you want to use your hymnal, let's stand together as we begin our worship this morning.
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, how he left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. I was lost, but Jesus found me, found the sheep that went astray. Through his loving arms around me, drew me back into his way. Yes, I'll sing.
Sunlight. Did you enjoy that sunlight this morning? What a gift from God. It was a little chilly, but it was beautiful. Amen.
Walking in sunlight. My soul.
joyful. Are you joyful this morning?
Yeah.
The joy of the Lord, the scripture says, is your strength. Amen?
Yeah.
When life gets you down, that joy can fill you up with his presence and his power. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Let's sing it together. Drew, if you would lead us in prayer, brother.
Thank you. Hello.
Sorry. Hi, y'all. I'll be over here.
Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? Does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? But when I look back, did he move every mountain? Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Did he defeat the darkness? Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Sometimes those voices try to tell me I'm forgotten and I've fallen too far from his hands. But I know what kind of God he is, and I'm trusting promises, I'm believing, and I'm singing, yes, he can. Whoa!
Did he move every mountain?
Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So, yes, he can. Did he defeat the darkness?
Did he deliver me?
Yes, he did. So, yes, he can. Yes, he did. So yes, he can. I've seen too much. Now I can't deny. He's come through every single time. From the beginning till the end.
He did, he will, he can.
So yes, he can. Whoa!
Did he defeat the darkness?
Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can.
Did he move every mountain?
Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Did he defeat the darkness? So yes, he can. Yes, he did. So yes, he can.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. You know, I pray for the music because it's an extension of our worship to Christ. Hallelujah. And I know there's a lot of different forms and fashion of that, and I just love mixing it up. Amen, David? Amen. Praise God. Well, Brother Wayne, I want to say thank you again for coming and joining us today. If you would, are you ready? Come on up here, friend. Let me pray you in here. And then whatever God's laid on your heart today, if you would, just be free to share. Amen, church?
Amen.
Come on up here and let's pray, friend. Amen. Father, today I want to say thank you for my brother Wayne. It's been 2 years. God, his testimony was very powerful. It touched our hearts. And many, many people said they loved Brother Wayne and him speaking to us about what God has done in his life. God is a miracle, and
God, even the word that you gave me this morning, that you're going to use him cross-culturally, Father, to reach people that maybe haven't been reached or he hadn't even thought of reaching, Father. I pray that for us as well, Father, that we would go beyond the people that we know, Father, and reach out to those that you love. You died for us all, Father. Mm-hmm. So thank you for this. God, I pray that every heart and mind in this room would be responsive to what you are speaking through Wayne this morning, and myself included, Father. Don't let me leave the same. In Jesus' name, amen, Brother Wayne. Amen.
Good morning. I greet you today in the wonderful name of our Lord and our Savior, our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. I am honored and I'm privileged to be back in Mercer Baptist Church. On behalf of the Grace Bible Baptist Church in the island of Trinidad, we want to thank you for your prayer, Mercer Baptist Church. We want to thank you for your support, your financial support. And the people in Trinidad told me when I get here, when I get to Mercer Baptist Church, let them know that every soul that is won in the island of Trinidad for Jesus, you will share in the reward of that soul. I want to thank your pastor, Pastor David. Pastor Carl. Well, it doesn't matter. You all look the same to me anyway. I want to thank you for the opportunity that you have given me, Pastor Carl, for sharing to you today, this morning, on the ministry in the island of Trinidad, and also to share with you from the Word of God. I want to thank Wendell Walker. 16 times, he came to Trinidad. 16 times. And he'd been like a father to many in the island of Trinidad. A mentor, a spiritual mentor, a spiritual father. We have learned so much from Wendell Walker. I don't call him Wendell Walker because I've been so close to him. You know when you are close to somebody, you give them a nickname? I'm so close to Wendell Walker. People in Trinidad are so close to him. We don't call him Wendell Walker. We call him Texas Ranger. He's the ranger, and we appreciate him so much. And I want to thank him for making all the arrangements. When I come to America, he makes all the arrangements for us to speak from one church to the next. I don't know where Charles Maple is, but I know he's connected with Charles Maple. Is he here? Is he around? He's not here today, but we want to thank Charles Maple for making the connection with Wendell Walker, both of them making the connection with your pastor, and giving me the opportunity this morning to come again and to share with you from the Word of God.
Brother Carl, give me a...
What's this? Microphone. A microphone. And I know when this thing goes, when the color changes red, that means to stop. It's like a bomb. It's like a bomb.
They just put in new batteries.
Oh, okay. Appreciate you very much. You know, my dad told me, he said, son, where are you going? I said, I'm going to America. He said, remember this. Remember this. I said, what, daddy? He said, black is beautiful. Brown is grand. But white is the color of the big boss man. I said, all right, daddy, I remember that. I remember that when I come to America. I have my wife, she's here, Alicia. I have one of my children here, that's Hope. Would you please stand? Amen. I have three girls and two boys. Five children, three girls, two boys, five of them, one wife, but five children. We must make that clear.
And we appreciate my wife also. I'm really thankful to be here in Worcester Baptist Church. I'm from the island of Trinidad, and for those of you who weren't here when I was here 2 years ago, Trinidad is an island in the Caribbean. It's the last island southward in the Caribbean. It's about 10 miles off the coast of Venezuela. So if you look at you go to the southern tip of Trinidad and you look across, you will see Venezuela. That's how close we are to Venezuela. The island is not a huge island, it's a small island. It is 75 miles long, 75, and it is 35 miles wide. 75 by 35, inhabited by 1.4 million people in that island. The temperature all year round, I must say this, is 90 degrees all year round. So coming to America, coming now, it's a shocker. I feel like I'm in a deep freeze here. When we came out this morning and I'm on the outside in the parking lot, I'm talking and I'm seeing something coming out from my mouth. This never happens in Trinidad. This is new, 90 degrees all year round. 1.4 million people. 40% of the people that live in Trinidad, 40% are Africans. Another 40% are Indians. Where we live in the southern part of Trinidad. And if you come to Trinidad, and I hope that you would, and make arrangements with the church to come, if you come to the southern part of Trinidad, you would feel like you're coming to a little India. Lots of Indians living in the southern part of Trinidad. You're probably wondering, how is it that we have Indians living in Trinidad? Trinidad was once a British colony. And the British people, they were looking for workers to work in the sugarcane field in Trinidad. So they went to India, and they brought the Indians over to work in Trinidad. The last shipment of Indians came in 1945. I am a third generation Indian that is living in the island of Trinidad. When the Indians came from India, they brought with them their culture, their way of life. They brought with them their religion. The religion of the Indians, generally speaking, the religion is Hinduism. So whenever you see an Indian, you will link Hinduism with the Indians. Hinduism, they believe in many gods. They have a god for health. They have a god for beauty. They have a god for wealth. They believe that the sun is a god. They believe the moon is a god. They believe the stars is a god. They believe that animals are god. They believe that the ocean is a god. They believe that this earth that we walk on, it's a god. They make their gods with their hands. They make it and sell it. They would make their gods out of clay and out of wood, out of metal, out of stone. Some of the gods that they make are about a foot high. Some of the gods are about 3 or 4 feet high. Some of the gods are about 7, 8 feet high. When you go to a Hindu home, you will see these smaller gods in the corner of their homes. And they would burn incense to these gods every day. And they would pray to these gods. When the sun is rising in the morning, the devout Hindus, they would go on the outside, and as the sun is rising, they would pray to the sun and chant. They believe that the sun is also a god. The taller gods, 7 foot high, 8 feet high gods, you would find them in their temples. So if you go to a Hindu temple, like how we have a service Sunday morning, they too have their services. And when you go to their temples, when you come in, as you open the doors and you look from one side of the temple all the way down to the other side of the temple, you will see gods. And they bow down and they worship these gods. That's polytheism, isn't it? Polytheism, many gods. The Bible, when you open the Bible doesn't teach you polytheism. The Bible teaches you monotheism. There are not many gods. The Bible teaches us that there is one God. Amen. Paul the Apostle makes it very clear in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 5. He says that there is one God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Not many, but one. Even in the commandments, Exodus chapter 20, God says, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Thou shalt have no other gods beside me. The Hindus live in direct disobedience to the word of God. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, remember this morning, that there is one God. He sits on the throne in heaven and he rules from on high. One God, not many God. The Hindus have a doctrine, they call it reincarnation. I mentioned it the last time. Reincarnation. That's their religion, that's their doctrine, reincarnation. Reincarnation teaches that when you live your life on the earth, you will do good and you will do bad. And when you die, hopefully, this is what they teach now, this is what they teach, this is what they believe. They believe it deep down in their heart. They believe that when you die, and if you do more good than bad, you will come back to life as a human being. And if when you die, you do more bad than good, when you die, you will come back as an animal. So a lot of them believe that their ancestors or their loved ones, they have come back either as an animal or as a human being. It's kind of funny. I was thinking about this morning. When a Hindu person dies, and like the next day a child is born, they will think that that person has come back again. That child that came back is a reincarnation of the person that died. They believe that, the Hindus. It's a religion. When they ask me back home, is Christianity a religion? Christianity is not a religion. I'll tell you why it is not a religion. Religion is man trying to reach God. Right? Man doing good. Man giving. Man praying. Man being sincere. Man being truthful in order to reach God. That's religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is not man trying to reach God, but Christianity is God coming down and reaching man. That's the difference between Christianity and all other religions in the world. God leaving his throne in heaven and coming down in search for man. Didn't Jesus say that? In Luke chapter 19 and verse 10, for the Son of Man is come to seek, help me finish it up. Come to seek and to save that which was lost. Christianity is Jesus coming down in search for us. They believe in reincarnation. They don't eat a lot of meat. You know why? They don't eat the cows. You know why? Because they think that maybe if grandpa die or grandma die, they may come back into an animal or cow, and you cannot eat the cow, because if you eat the cow, you may be eating grandpa or grandma. Now, in Trinidad, we have to try to reach the Hindu people. And you cannot eat meat in front of them. Because if you eat meat in front of them, you offend them. So you'll find that a lot of the Hindus, they eat more vegetables. They don't eat the meat. And we cannot eat meat. We cannot be around them and be comfortable and eat meat. We can't do it. We can't eat the cow. We can't eat beef around them. So when I come to America, when I come to America and I land in Miami Airport, now I'm teaching my wife and I'm teaching my daughter to do this. When I land in Miami Airport, the first thing that I do is that I order not a Whopper, I order a double Whopper with cheese. Because I can eat it without offending anybody in America. Hopefully there are no Indians around, without offending or making anybody uncomfortable. So I thank God for America. Thank God for beef. Thank God for hamburgers. Thank God for Longhorn. We don't have Longhorn in Trinidad. You know, when I stand to preach, I always start with the Bible. I stay in the Bible, and I finish up in the Bible. They teach reincarnation. You open the Bible, you don't find reincarnation. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27, it is appointed unto men one time to die. You don't die and born back and die and born back. They believe that you can do that 476,000 times. The Bible says it is appointed unto men once to die. The Bible does not teach reincarnation. The Bible teaches, however, regeneration. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot even see heaven." Nicodemus looked at the Lord and said, "Lord, but how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus emphatically said to him again, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." In order for you to get to heaven, you must be regenerated. You must be born again. Paul says in Titus 3:5, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and by the renewing of the Holy Spirit." In order for you to make it, it's not about you. It's not about me. It's about God's mercy. It's about God doing for us through his son Jesus what we cannot do for ourselves. Jesus dying on the cross. Carl, is Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and paying a price that we couldn't pay? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for coming. Thank you for leaving your throne where angels would bow to you. That place of privileged position, you leave there and you came in search for us to save us from our sins. Thank you, Lord, for coming. Thank you for the regenerating power done by the Holy Spirit of God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. The Hindus have a devilish system. It's called the caste system. It's a system that says you cannot believe in any other gods but the Hindu gods. And if you believe in any other gods but the Hindu gods, they will throw you out of the home. And they will no longer consider you to be a father, a mother, a brother, a sister. You'll be kicked out of the home. When they came from India, they did something very, very tactful. In order to carry on their belief and their religion, what they have done, they have built schools, elementary schools. So when you're growing up, you have no choice but to send, like these little kids here, you have no choice but to send them to one of the elementary schools. That's between ages 5 to 12. And when you go to the elementary school, they will indoctrinate you and indoctrinate you in Hinduism. And when you hear something repeated over and over and over, more than likely you will become. They have done that very tactfully. When I was small, I had no choice but to attend one of the elementary Hindu schools. I can stand here and I can repeat some of the prayers that I have learned. They would make you worship the gods when you go to their schools. Yes, they have their idols in their schools too. You have to worship the gods. You have to bow down to the gods. But ladies and gentlemen, I want to say this morning that when I was 12 years old, Jesus saved me. He saved me out of darkness. He saved me out of religion. I was, at 12 years old, there was this fear that came upon my heart. And it became very heavy. I was afraid to die. And I didn't know at the time, but now I know that the Spirit of God was drawing me to Christ. Because he's the only one who can remove fear and remove the death. You being afraid to die. That fear of being afraid to die, only Jesus Christ can remove that. And I was searching for someone. I was searching, and Jesus found me and saved me. And I want to thank God for his saving power. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Thank you, Lord, when I was 12 years old. Thank you that you saved me. You reached down in Trinidad, and a little island in Trinidad. Many people in the world, they don't even know where Trinidad is. You reached down there, and you saved me, and I thank you. I thank you. When I was 17 years old, there was this thing called the American Dream. Big house, SUV, money in the bank. I said, Lord, if ever I have the opportunity to come to America, I want to live the American Dream. I too want a big house. I too want an SUV. Yesterday we were driving, and I saw something called RV. I asked the man, I said, what is RV? He said, recreational vehicle. He told me that's part of the American Dream. I was like, man, RV. I'm in Trinidad, and I'm saying if ever I get the opportunity to come to America, listen, this is my plan. This is what I already planned out my life when I was 17. I want to come to America. I want to work hard. I want to live the American dream and live up my life. That's me. You know something? When I was 17 years old, I landed in South Carolina. I walked into the administration building, and the administrator asked me, what do you want for your major? What would you like to choose? You have 4 years. RV. Money. Pool in the back. What do you think I chose? I told you the last time. What do you think I chose as my major? Accounting. I did accounting for 4 years. And the last 2 weeks before graduation, the accounting firms were coming in on campus and they were interviewing people. And they interviewed me and they hired me off the bat 2 weeks before graduation. I am ready to live my life. I am ready to go my way. 2 weeks before graduation, I went back and I lay down on the bed and I closed my eyes. And when I closed my eyes, I was seeing little children running around. And I opened back my eyes. What's happening? So I looked around to see if there were children around. There were no children. I closed back my eyes. And when I closed back my eyes, I began to see little children running around, bowing down to these little idols and worshiping these idols. And then a voice said to me, whom shall I send and who will go for me? I knew there, clear as daylight, I knew that the Lord wanted me to go back to Trinidad and to start preaching his word. I knew he was calling me back to Trinidad. But I wanted to stay in America. I wanted to live life in America. That was my way. But you remember, the Bible says God's ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. I already planned out my life, but the Lord said, I give you a choice. Choose you this day. Will you go back for me, or will you live in America? I wrestled and wrestled until I yielded, and I said, Lord, send me back home. Send me back home. I will do your will, O Lord. I went back home in the island of Trinidad. Here am I, Carl, a university graduate, Bachelor of Science degree and Master's degree. Lord said, go back home. And you see that church there? I want you to start there. The church was 15 feet wide. 15 feet wide. And it was about 25 feet long. Had about 15 or 20 people. The Lord said, I want you to go back there. Some of the poorest people in the world. Go back there and start there. When my dad got saved, he second generation Indian, when he got saved, he was kicked out of his house. And he began to walk in the street and he began to live on the street. And the Lord called him to preach. My dad, I'm telling you, the Lord called him to preach. The first sermon that my dad preached, he didn't have no churches around to preach. The first sermon he preached was on the street. He was standing on the street and the Lord said, all right, get ready to preach. So my dad began to preach the first sermon on the street. Right to the right of where my dad was preaching was a Hindu temple. You don't preach your first sermon next to a Hindu temple. The Hindu priest was living next to the temple. He heard somebody was calling out the name of Jesus next to his temple. He got mad. He took a club and he walked down. He said, who is that next to my temple? When he walked down, he saw my dad and he recognized my dad. And he said, you know what? Let me just hear what this young man is preaching. And my dad said when he finished preach his first sermon, he looked across and he saw the Hindu priest down on his knees giving his heart to the Lord. The next day, my dad and the Hindu priest went into the Hindu priest's temple, took all the idols out from the temple, loaded in a truck, went down by the riverside, dumped all the idols in the river, came back and converted the Hindu temple into a Baptist church. To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise your name, Lord. The Lord said, now, that's where I want you to start. I want you to start right there in that converted Hindu temple with 15 people. Start right there and trust me. Start there, believe me, and trust me. For 1 year, Carl, 1 year I've been working with the people. Just like you did in Sri Lanka, you would go and invite people. And when people would tell you that they would come, and then Sunday they don't show up. That happened to me for 1 year. 1 year. People are set in their ways. And the older they are, the more they are set in their ways. And they wouldn't come. And I'm thinking, well, what to do? How can I help grow the church? And I remembered a time when Jesus was preaching. And the people were coming. And they were bringing the children. And the disciples told the parents, take back the children. If you bring the children will disturb the master as he teach and as he's preaching. And you remember what Jesus said? Remember what he said to the disciples? Suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. And I said, aha, that's it. That's where to start. Start with the children. Where our church is, there's a village here, there's a village here, there's a village here, there's a village there, a village, all villages all around the church. And in these villages, we have children who have never heard the gospel. The Lord said, take the gospel into the villages. And I took the gospel into the villages. We started a ministry called the Awana Ministry. And we began to reach the children. And the children began to come to the ministry. The children began to get saved because for the first time they are hearing John 3:16. Could you quote it with me, John 3:16? For God, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I'm nearing the 12 o'clock hour. Make sure this is still. I'm getting there. The children begin to get saved. The parents want, Hindu parents, we're talking about Hindu people and Muslims. They wanted to know what was going on with the children. They came to the church and they began to get saved. And we began to baptize them into the church. By the year 2000, we needed to build a church. A number of churches in America helped, and we built a church in Trinidad. It has been 20 years since we've been in the church. 20 years. And our church been doing well since the COVID hit, man. The COVID came and give people a good reason to stay away from church. It's people who wanted a reason to stay away, they got it. But the ones who are faithful to the Lord, they will come no matter what. They keep coming. I want to compliment all of you here this morning. You keep coming and you keep trusting the Lord. How many times the word of God says, fear not, fear not. We thank you for being courageous. And we thank you for standing with Mercer Baptist Church. God bless you. Give yourself a round of applause. Everybody. Man, you come out this morning. You're here this morning to worship the Lord. It has been 20 years since we've been in the church now. And we are baptized into the church, Hindus and Muslims. Last year, we baptized 9 of them. All together in 20 years since we moved into the new church, we have baptized 684 converted Hindus and Muslims into the church. Bless the Lord. The children ministry is growing. Bless the Lord for that. Presently, we are training 25 men for ministry. Right now, 25 men for ministry. So I want you to continue to pray for the work back home. We have many needs, many needs. We people who come to the church, a lot of them are poor. We try to give them rice. Well, the ranger helps a lot in that. We try to buy rice for them. We try to buy flour for them. We try to give them clothes. We have many needs. Well, one of the greatest needs that we have right now is to buy a small van. One of the van that broke down, the government totaled the van. And if we don't get a van to bring the children from the village, about 60 children would be left behind. And if we don't go for them, I tell you who will go for them. The Jehovah Witness will go for them. And the Mormons will go for them. So I pray that you pray for that need, for a small little van for the work in Trinidad. Hebrews, Paul tells us, and I close with this. Paul tells us in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 10, God is not unfaithful. God is not unjust that he will forget your work and your labor of love that you have done towards his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and you do minister. I want to thank Mercer Baptist Church. I want to thank you from the depths of my heart for all that you do for the work in Trinidad. And for those of you who are saved, I hope you are saved. There's a song that we used to sing, if you're saved and you know it, say amen. Amen. If you're saved and you know it, clap your hands. Well, that's not you all, but that's one that we do back home. But I pray that you're saved. Because death can come knocking at your door anytime. You better be prepared for death. Death is like a door that takes one from time into eternity. There are only two eternal destinations, one called heaven and one called hell. The choice that you make in this life, and you have one time to make it, the choice that you make in this life will determine where you spend eternity. If you choose Jesus from your heart, not from your lip, not in your head, but if you choose Jesus Christ from your heart, you will spend eternity in heaven, guaranteed in heaven forever. But if you reject Jesus Christ because of your pride or because of ignorance, if you reject Jesus Christ, you will live in that horrible place that is called hell, that was prepared for the devil and his angels and for all those who refuse to bow their hearts to Jesus Christ. Choose Jesus and you will live forever. Reject Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. You will live forever too if you reject Jesus. But you will not live forever with him in heaven. But you will live forever in that horrible, dreadful place that is called hell. Make your choice. Choose Jesus. Thank you, and God bless every one of you. Thank you.
Church? Amen. Amen. Well, if the ushers would come forward, let's take up a special love offering for the work in Trinidad. And I know one of the things I love about Mercer Baptist Church is your faithfulness, obviously, to the local church, but then also when we do a special offering. So thank you, men, for this. Miss Sherry, thank you for playing. Amen. Joe, before we go out, would you pray for us, sir?
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for each person who come out today, Father. We know we're not here by accident. We're here by divine appointment.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for Brother Wayne and preaching that he just laid on our heart, Father. The words we heard come out of his mouth, Father. Father, I pray that you bless his ministry in a mighty way.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, just help this church to help them, Father. Father, just bless him. Just fill him out everywhere he goes, Father, like you did today. Father, just keep him safe. Father, we know that you guide, you'll provide, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, I pray for this offering today that it would just be blessed in a mighty way. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Amen, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have you all been blessed today? You know, I was just thinking about this, but in Scripture, it talks about that the Lord will give us the islands. Amen? And we're so honored that God has allowed us to minister in Sri Lanka, which is an island, and Trinidad, which is an island. Amen? And we're just going to keep praying for you. Obviously, we, a couple years ago, last time you were here, we promised we'll come see you, and then COVID hit, and it didn't work. But, you know, I just really want to pray that God would allow us to come see the work and love on your people at some point in time as well. And, Brother Wendell, I love you. Thank you so much for your ministry you've done, and thank you for allowing me to be a part of it. Amen, friend? Texas Ranger. I like that. I might adopt that. But we love you, Wayne. Thank you, Lisa, for sharing your husband and Hope. Amen? Did you enjoy yourself? Sounds good. Well, church, I hope you feel blessed. Hey, if you if just come up and love on them, amen, before they head out, just encourage them. And we thank you for your generosity. You feel blessed? I'm blessed. Good word, friend. Amen. And if you're around me long enough, I do look better than all the other white people you'll ever meet. I will say really fast, I know you want to go and you don't want me to talk anymore, but my wife and I, we lived in Singapore for so many years that when we came back to America, we landed in Chicago, and my kids were scared. And I said, why are you scared? And they said, there's so many white people, and they all look the same. So you kind of, where you live in, you end up seeing people for all their characteristics, so... amen, friend. Amen. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And yes, I heard my name. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ladies, there's a lot of stuff going on. Pick up a flyer and make sure to sign up for those events. Amen, church. Anyone else? Word from the Lord or announcement? Well, let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, this day we say thank you, Lord, for the work that you're doing around the world. Lord, you're saving souls moment by moment, harvest by harvest, seed by seed. Lord, I pray for Wayne's ministry. Father, that he is going to reach more than the Hindus. He's going to reach to the rest of Trinidad. Father, it's not just a southern thing, but it's a nation wide body of Christ. And Lord, I pray for him. I want to say thank you for what you're doing with him and his sweet wife and children. God, bless them. Whatever they put their hands to, may it prosper for your glory, Father. Bless Brother Wendell and his ministry, Father. Lord, give him strength and encouragement and hope, Father, in his ministry as well. Father, thank you for your bride. Thank you for their generosity. Thank you for their love. I pray they're blessed, God, as they go out this week. And Father, they're so blessed. They couldn't even imagine how blessed they feel. Father, tend to all their needs. God, we say thank you first and foremost for our salvation. Thank you for saving our souls. Lord, if there's somebody today that's really pondering that, the Bible says if you believe in your heart that Jesus did that and you confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. It's that easy. With the heart, man believes. With the mouth, the confession is made. And so today, may they believe it in their heart. Ask you to say, Jesus, please, save my soul, forgive me. And then seal them with the Holy Spirit. Birth in the Spirit. Feeling your presence and your love from this day forward. Lord, may they come out. Ask us more information about that. May they come out and want to know more about you. Lord, thank you for your love for us. I pray your blessings upon your people. May the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may your face shine upon you and give grace to you the rest of this day and all week. Amen, church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.